Friends, welcome to another episode of Day Out with a Star. Thanks for making this platform so popular. For us, every one of you is a star. We make it very easy for fans to meet and get inspired by amazing individuals. And today I'm very proud to have with me Dr. Shashi Kant. Welcome, Dr. Shashi Kant.
Thank you.
Dr. Shashi Kant is the director of the master's program of University of Toronto and our next human star. Dr. Shashi Kant, you just recently received the Order of Ontario, which is one of the highest accolade of the state of Canada, Ontario. Can you tell me a little more about it?
Thank you for inviting me. As far as Order of Ontario is concerned, is the highest honor of the province. Mm-hmm. And it is awarded to the people who have shown outstanding qualities of individual excellence and achievement in any field.
Okay. So that's for any field, right?
Yeah, that is for any field, not limited to forestry or not limited to the professors. They can be artists, they can be actors, they can be activists, in any field.
No, that's really great. You truly deserve the award. Before we start on anything, this is my favorite question. Who is Shashi Kant? Can you tell me a little about your background and your childhood and your history?
Yeah, I was born in a village in India, in Uttar Pradesh. When I grew up, that in village, there was no running water, no electricity, no road. It was very close to Ganges River, so we used to go play in that descent of Ganges.
Okay.
And there was only a primary school in the village. So I studied in that village up to grade 5.
Right.
And then I moved to a city where I did my BSc.
Mm-hmm.
This is my brother was living there, so I lived with him in a small city.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously my whole, you can say, the philosophy and thinking has been influenced where I grew up.
Right.
And that has not changed even after doing PhD in Canada and learning economics in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So that goes with me. And that is, you can say, that has saved Shashi Kant more than the education or anything else.
Yeah.
And then I did my... the Bachelor of Engineering from BITS Plani.
Okay.
And after that, I moved to the Forest Service in India. And after working in Forest Service and then Indian Institute of Forest Management, then I came to Canada. But during this time, I interacted or many people influenced my life.
I was just trying to ask you, what was the role of your family and friends in shaping your life?
Right. So in terms of family, obviously that time, like early 60s, my family definitely supported me and provided the support to study because everybody was not able to go to school and study.
Right.
But my father and my brother, they definitely wanted to me study. So they provided all support, not only financial support, but the support in terms of that I should pursue, continue to study.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother, who was living in place where I did my early education after primary school, he was a professor in college. So definitely his thinking and his support and his educational support saved my early life.
Right.
But once I came to Forest Service, it was my first boss, Mr. Grishchand Pandey, who has a most impact on my life in terms of commitment to society, away from corruption, like dead honest.
Right, that's an important thing in India, right?
Yeah. Dead honest person who will not even provide government vehicle for his wife or something. So honesty on one side, but on the other side, he has such a wild knowledge. You can talk to him on any subject. He was a chemist, basically. But he so great in astronomy, astrology, field botanist. So he said, like, he had a lot of impact on my life as a as an individual. But also my learning or reading of Gandhi's work has also saved my life. And then when I came to Canada, then my supervisor here, Jagdish Nautiyal, he was has been also instrumental in thinking and moving me more toward spirituality.
That's very important thing. I think forestry and spirituality go together.
yeah, and that is very important thing for being a human being.
Right, exactly. And, no, that's an amazing story from a village, a small village in India, to like a world stage in Canada, to University of Toronto. A small child could have never thought about it. What kept you on?
Yeah, so what kept you on was definitely was something like I was, in a way you can say what kept me on was I was not satisfied whatever I was doing wherever I was.
Exactly.
And I see the light of doing more than what I was doing there.
Yes.
And then also the other thing what kept me on everywhere, wherever I worked, whether it was in the Forest Service or Indian Institute of Forest Management or University of Toronto, I find some friends who friends and students also who have been, like, I learned a lot from them. In addition to learning a lot from them, the reward which I get is more from the appreciation or happiness by those students, what I do with them. And that's kept me going on because, like I'm doing something which is appreciated by the people, so I have to continue to do more and more. The other thing which also, and which may come later on also, when I came to Canada, I learned a lot from First Nations people here. And also their persistence, whatever they have gone through.
Right.
That is also a very, you can say, encouraging thing. Like when these people can persist for centuries and centuries, whatever hardship they face, then why not, when I am in a better, much better position, why not I can continue to do the things which I believe in?
No, that's an amazing, amazing story. You are an institutional builder. You were among the first to start the Indian Institute of Forest Management, Bhopal. You were the pioneer. Tell me more about the challenges and the first taste of success in building a historic institution.
Yeah, no, that was a great learning for myself because I came to IAFM from government job, Forest Service, and I was almost right in the beginning when first class came there, I was there. And it was a great challenge for everybody, not for only me, but for everybody who was there that time.
Right.
To make that PGDFM successful.
Right.
And I think because of my forestry background and also economics background that time, and also I have learned some management, people had a faith in me. And I, as you may recall, I took almost every coordinatorship there. First was the program coordinatorship, and then the OT coordinatorship, and then the second batch was the even placement coordinatorship. And I think the main reason for my success was two or three things I will say. One is I can think ahead.
Okay.
Even
that's an important, really important thing that you are telling us.
Yeah, because the finding the internship for the first class, going to World Bank, going to the WWF and all those organizations, that was, I think, thinking ahead. Second was definitely the support of the director and the support or the trust of the student who were there. And the third one, there were opportunities which were not explored.
Right.
As you know, when IFM was started, there were so many doubts. Oh, what will happen to the graduates of the IFM?
Right.
Forest Service already, they take from the UPSC, so where these students will go. But there were so much untapped opportunities which people never thought that forestry people can go there. And somehow me and Jitender and the other people there, I think we as a group were able to see those opportunities and approach those people. And the other one was obviously the students were selected through the highly competitive process. And they were the smart and the brightest people. So when you go to these organizations and talk about a student and then a student perform, so all those like student support, opportunities, thinking ahead, going and talking to anybody, all that helped to save that institute that time.
No, as one of your first RFM students, I can truly say that you made my career. So thank you for everything.
No, I don't think I made your career. But you made your career and I was a tool in that one somewhere.
No. Yeah, I was really impressed by the credible and really talented faculty that was assembled at IFM. And I was also enamored by all the subjects that you taught, like the forest resource economics, sustainable management, and the common property resource management. Tell me, is it possible to manage forests really sustainably in the face of so many externalities and external pressures?
Yeah, so in terms of sustainability, my thoughts have evolved a lot since I taught at Indian Institute of Forest Management. And I think here that spirituality might have played a role, because earlier I used to believe that, we have to teach economics, we have to teach the forest silviculture, like all social science, management science, and the forest science, which is great. But as you also said, like there are so many externalities there, and there are so many unknown factors. So knowing the science or knowing the technology is important. And they play a very important role. But the most important thing in sustainability, or either sustainable forest management or sustainability in general, is human behavior.
Yes.
Whether you have a technology, but if you don't change your human behavior, nothing is going to change. So the most important thing is we as a human being, how we think about either forest or any other environment or any other resource. And our education system is not guided or directed towards developing better human beings. They are more producing mechanical human beings. So for sustainability, I think what I believe is the managing sustainable forest as a sustainable resource or managing any other resource on sustainability principles is very important to direct our education to make people better human beings. And better human beings is also everybody thinks about other people. Like we all are connected. And so this externality problem can be solved only when we think about other people. What we are doing, how it is harming other people or benefiting other people. Unless that comes in our decision making, in our thought process, it is very difficult. So, yes, forests can be managed sustainably, but we have to work more on human aspect.
Exactly. No, I completely agree with you on that. Canada and Toronto. How did that happen?
I missed your few words.
What I was saying is Canada and University of Toronto. What made you seek a foreign ground in Canada and join University of Toronto?
So that was as when I was at Indian Institute of Forest Management, Bhopal, and that was the best period of my life in India as a professor. Like it was, I was in forest service, which was good, and I was okay there, but I was not very happy. That's why I came to Indian Institute of Forest Management, and as a teacher there, I think I was very happy. And that time I made a decision that my future life will be in the teaching profession. So I came to Canada to do my PhD.
Okay.
In forest economics. So I came here, I did my PhD. I had a plan to go back to India and do teaching somewhere, either Indian Institute of Forest Management or some other institute. Mm-hmm. But luckily, I got a job just after 2 months after finishing my PhD.
Okay.
So that's how I landed up in University of Toronto. In University of Toronto being the one of the top 20, 25 universities in the world, top in Canada. I couldn't have imagined anything better than there in terms of the academic career.
No.
So that is a choice, not intentional choice, but it happened. By all the, you can say, stars aligned at that time.
Right.
Then I stayed at University of Toronto.
No. I think that more than the star aligning, you also proved yourself, and that's came into being with the Queen Award in Forestry that you received. Can you tell me more about it?
Yeah. So first thing, before Queen Award, as you said, more than a star aligned. One thing I would like to say, that University of Toronto job. Also, when I came to do my PhD at U of T, my supervisor right in the beginning, he said that you have come here, you will do the PhD, you will finish the PhD, but you have to decide what you want to do.
Right.
And he tell, if you want to do the academic career, then you have to publish.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to go back to India after this degree, then you can do your degree,
go back.
So that definitely helped me, because even during my PhD degree, my 7 papers were published.
Wow.
And other were in the process. So that's how you can also say I got this University of Toronto job, because normally you don't publish that many papers.
Mm-hmm.
And that also, whatever my supervisor said, also helped whatever I achieved in future years. So in terms of the Queen's Award in Forestry, Queen's Award in Forestry is awarded by the Commonwealth Forestry Association. And this award is for people who make long-lasting impact on forestry sector in Commonwealth countries.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not for any one particular paper or research, but they see what you have done over the years.
Okay.
So my forestry research has been, right from the beginning, was more on sustainability, communities, and forest economics.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe the normal forest economics, like the, you can say, the neoclassical forest economics, because neoclassical basic assumption is every person is the maximizer or self utility maximizer or the selfish, in other words.
Right.
Which right from my childhood I saw, no, there are people who are selfish, and everybody may have some element of the selfishness in some. But in many cases, they care for other people. And
exactly.
And so that has been my work right even from the beginning, my PhD thesis, where I try to prove that it's not only privatization, which is economically efficient, but even community management, community forest management can be economically efficient.
Mm-hmm.
It depends how you look at economic efficiency.
Right.
If you include all social costs, then the privatization is not economically efficient, while the community management can be definitely the efficient.
Right.
And my whole research has been focused on that. So what this Commonwealth Forest Association looked. Not only my research, then my forestry-related extracurricular activities.
Okay.
I organized a conference in 2007, just before when I got the Queen's Award.
Right.
Which was developing a global vision of forestry, where we brought people from all different countries. And before that, I organized conferences in China, India. So they looked overall impact on the forestry sector, and that time impact and potential impact.
No. I think your body of research is amazing. You have published 5 books and more than 100 referred journal articles and book chapters. Tell us about your books. What are they about, and what do they convey?
Yeah. So there are, I will categorize five books in three categories. My first book was, we did work in India, which was community forest management in Odisha, where communities were protecting forest, but nobody noticed that. So we brought up that, and also that played a lot of role in 1989 forest policy in India and later on joint forest management notifications in India. The second three books are, I started a book series on sustainability, economics, and natural resources.
Okay.
So the idea here was integrating the concept of sustainability in natural resource economics, which again, it is beyond neoclassical economics. And also the idea in this was more of integrating different disciplines in the sustainability. So those, there are three volumes from this book series, which are edited by me. There are other volumes also. And the last book is a handbook of forest resource economics.
Wow.
So this is a handbook, the providing the, at that time, it was published in 2014, the current label of state or current state of forest economics. So papers contributed by different authors, but covers wide, very wide topics in forest economics.
Okay. You have, you were able to create such a body of work. Institutional builder, you again started to work and develop the Master's in Sustainability program at University of Toronto. Tell me more about the program and why and who should join that program.
Yeah, so this is a very unique program, Master's of Science in Sustainability Management, which we started or were able to start in 2014. The main thing here of program, I will tell you few key features of the program and then who should come and why they should come. The most important feature of this program is our, the philosophy of the program is there is no environmental sustainability or social sustainability or economic sustainability. There is only one sustainability. Sustainability, environmental, social, economic, these are all different aspects of sustainability. And unless you look all these aspects together and you address those aspects together, you are not moving in the direction of sustainability. Because why the problem of sustainability itself has arisen? Because we look separately. More focus on economics, forget about environment, and then we started problems related to environment. Similarly, more focus on economics, no focus on social side, you have a problem of sustainability. Same if you do, either you focus on environment more, you focus on social more, you will create other problems. So this program looks sustainability in an integrative manner.
Okay.
That is the key feature. But the also the other thing is the program is also integration of social science, management science, and natural science. So the course is, it's not like it is little different at now from IFM program.
Right.
Because they have the, we have the courses there also in social science and the natural science and management science, but there was no integration there. Here, every course, whether it is related to, say, organizational behavior or whether it is related to ecosystem science, they all are designed through the lens of sustainability.
Okay.
So sustainability is part of every course there. And the third thing is also this program is very applied. It's not theoretical. It is a professional program.
Right. So
we have a research paper in the program. We have an internship in the program. We also have a capstone in the program.
Okay.
So program also gives the opportunity that you can, you can have a general background in management as well as in social science and the natural science, but then you can specialize in any of the areas.
Okay.
You can specialize in marketing, you can specialize in climate change, you can organize in water, or you can specialize in the organizational behavior. So the the basic idea is that sustainability should be integrated in all managerial functions or all scientific functions. So you have a sustainability background, then if you go as a marketing, you will do it as a marketing professional with a sustainability background. So it's not a separate, like it is more of an integration at all levels. So that is the, you can say, the key features of the program. The other key feature, which is unique, which is we place a lot of emphasis here, that we are Masters of Science in Sustainability Management family. So I give a talk, and I believe the there are same features in love and sustainability. So love is a very a thread of the program. If you talk any student, they will talk, what is the uniqueness of this program? Oh, we love each other so much. We love sustainability so much. So that is what I was talking earlier, like, as a human being, it's not only teaching the technology and the managerial aspect, but to grow a student as a human being. And the students really, really have been very, not appreciative, but very, like, they ingrained in the program. It becomes their program. So coming back to your question, who should come? People who believe in changing the world, number one. People who are looking a degree only for some finding a job, that is, it's not a program for those people. It is a program for those people who have a desire that, oh, I need to go and do something to change the state of the world for the happiness of all the people. The second one is also people who are open. Like the who are open for science, who are open for management, who are open for social science, and who are open also for doing new things. The people who have a very state mindset, is this is not the program for those people. The program also for those people who are willing to transform their, themselves as a human being. Like even the program, when a student say, come, I say, you come here, most likely you will graduate. Unless you screw up totally. It doesn't matter for me whether you get a B plus or A minus or A or A plus. What matters for me is how well you, when you pass out, how different you are as a human. So those type of people, we interview people and we try to see that they match what we are looking. And also we put a lot of emphasis that like you are, the students are good for the program, but also program is good for a student.
No, that's a very important thing that you said, that you are good for the program and it's good for the students too. Popularity with students, you have, you are a great hit among your students. Share with us some examples of amazing warmth and friendship that you have created with your students.
Yeah, so if I go back to Indian Institute of Forest Management, then definitely I think from, I was there only for first three classes. And third class I left in between when I came to Canada. So basically I was only with first two classes. And with both classes, I think I had a great relationship with almost every student in the program, and they all are doing great work. And here, with all my PhD students, like in the program in forestry, because that was more focused there. But I have now with MScSM program, our fourth class is here. Two classes have graduated and two are in the program. And I have like the amazing relationship with almost every student. Because my focus, people also ask, oh, whom you think is the most successful student in the program. And my philosophy is that everybody is successful. It depends how you define successful. Like somebody may be doing something with the people who may be very happy and making impact there. As another person may have a, started a startup and work there, but they both are successful in their own way. And here, which was not at IFM, this whole idea of love and family, which I have started, which has made like the rewarding for me and rewarding to a student, and also the student's appreciation of whatever I do or we do here. Like I have two amazing staff people. clear best care who look after the placement and internship, and then the Rosemary Craig who looks admissions and recruitment and everything. Mm-hmm. And they all are in the same value system.
Okay.
So the relationship with every student, like it is not they can come and talk to one of three of us, any problem. Mm-hmm. Like there's this family problem, their breakup problem, their financial problem, their academic problem. And I think that is, that's not limited to one or two students. It's for whole class.
No, yeah. When I was in IFM, the one big thing about me, about the success, what it was like a one big family.
Yeah.
Right. So yeah, that thing, I think like, forestry, environment, and love for nature brings out those positive values.
Yeah. And also, if you see common thing in love, what is in love? You respect others.
Right.
You try to integrate what different people say. If you love the people, then you don't disregard those whatever they are saying.
Exactly.
And also, you try to balance whatever different people are saying.
Mm-hmm.
You are not saying, oh, this is right and this is right, but balance and integrate and respect.
No, you are completely right on it.
And same thing is sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
Sustainability, people have different preferences, different values, but we have to respect people's different stakeholders' preferences, values. We have to balance those. Like it is not that one can get all the things, what that is his preference or her preference, and other cannot get anything. We have to balance them. We have to integrate those preferences.
No,
so
I can't.
Love and sustainability have so much common element.
Mm-hmm.
And once you start loving something, then you do all that. You respect those. If you respect sustainability. And you integrate it and you balance it.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, in fact, my talk to the second class of our incoming class, Love and Sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
And I try to demonstrate like it is not just like preaching love and sustainability, but there are so many common elements. And if you see through that lens, then there's no reason if you want to do sustainability, then you will fall in love and sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
And once you fall in love and sustainability, then you do all these things. And that's the only way you can achieve sustainability, just not by introducing the new technology, which is good. It has its own part.
Yeah. Right. Making forestry profession attractive. We see a lot of disillusioned students leaving the forestry and environment sector in India and developing countries and take up roles in more glamorous sector like IT and finance. How can we change that?
Yeah, so what, like that is the, I think a lot about that. And one is, I think the problem less with the students, but more with the parents. Because there are also many students and Chinese students we interview for MScSM program, and we ask them, like, even if we accept you to this program, will your parents let you come to this program?
Okay.
So the parents' mindset is, oh, if he's working in Google or big company making more money, he's more happy or something.
Right.
So I think it is not an issue of forestry or environment, but the important issue is where an individual, a student, after doing the degree, find more happiness what he or she is doing.
Right.
Many people who go and work in a big company, Google, they find, oh, I can become a mechanical person every day, 9 to 5, go and do the things, but I have no say to change the functioning within the Google or any big company.
Right.
While if they are working with a small company, they think, oh, I can make this company to go in a direction where I want to go.
Right.
And that gives them more satisfaction, more happiness.
Mm-hmm.
So my message is for Indian parents, and for that matter, or Indian Chinese or developing countries, or for any parent, is they should look the happiness of their kids.
Mm-hmm.
Like the problem is with most of us, we look our kids' happiness in our happiness.
Right.
If we are happy, then kid will be happy. So, okay, you go do this degree, because then I'm happy, so my son will be also happy. While the happiness should be looked, if you look, like even the love, what is love? Mm-hmm. If you love your son or your daughter or your kid, mm-hmm. you should see your happiness in their happiness.
Right, exactly.
If they are happy, then you should be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So even if that student, your son, want to go to for an environmental degree or even does not want to go to college or university, want to after high school, want to do a job, mm-hmm. but want see himself happy, then you should be happy.
No, so, it's a very important thing that you are saying, that happiness is a really guiding principle. But what do you think about the guidance of, like you said, that you are not happy with your current existence, so you started building yourself, doing next thing and next thing and next thing. So I think that that is the very important thing, that people should be inquisitive, curious, and try to do something for the society.
Right. No, definitely. Those values are very important, as I was saying in the mm-hmm. beginning, like selfishness and the other regarding, like we should feel ourselves part of the society. We are part of the society.
Exactly.
Like, we affect the society and we are affected by the society, but we think, oh, I'm individual or something. So definitely that is very important thing, that we all, like whether the student or the mm-hmm. not non-student, we all have responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
We have a responsibility to society. We have responsibility to people surrounding us.
Right.
And we also have our duties.
Mm-hmm.
We have to contribute to those mm-hmm. duties.
No. What next? What is your next goal in mind?
Yeah. So my next goal is, because this program is going very well, which I have started.
Uh-huh.
And there are students who are going and doing amazing work.
Mm-hmm.
But I am thinking to start a organization
mm-hmm.
outside university structure, like independent organization, sustainability
mm-hmm.
organization.
Mm-hmm.
And the main aim of that organization, you can say, will be that what is most important for sustainability is intrinsic motivation.
Mm-hmm.
The technology and all those are great, but unless we make the people intrinsically motivated to save this world, it is very difficult to achieve sustainability.
Right.
And to do that, we need to do many things, like one program is not enough. We need to create, we need to have a different media, like changing the student, not students, kids' mindset. Like we have to start at the kids' level.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, and for that, it is not only teaching in education, like what they watch.
Mm-hmm.
What they like kids, you know, nowadays, they are on
exactly.
laptop and iPad.
So if they are on Snapchat and Facebook, you have to be there, right?
Yeah, you have to be there. And also, you have to develop some games, some small movies and something
yes.
for which they become addicted. Like they are addicted for whatever.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. You are completely with me on this.
Yeah, so that is, I think, my next move. And with this Order mm-hmm. of Ontario and recognition
mm-hmm.
of...
Mm-hmm.
I see Order of Ontario not the recognition of what I have done, but more of my value system.
Certainly, certainly.
And it gives me more encouragement, and I hope other people will come and support what mm-hmm. I want to do in that one. So with mm-hmm. that all, you mm-hmm. can say on back of... With this, the backing of that, mm-hmm. My next plan is to launch a mm-hmm. new sustainability organization. Mm-hmm. I have asked my student to develop what mm-hmm. this organization should do, mm-hmm. what its name should be, and all those. So we are working on that.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully within next few mm-hmm. months, we should be able to launch that organization and develop that one.
No, and as I said, I'll be very happy to be associated with that and our Day Out with the Star platform. And personally, that is what we want, that people ultimately, our planet yeah. should be sustainable with
yeah.
the people with them, right?
Yeah. No, thank you for those words. Definitely, you are the technological super man there. So I will... Definitely, we should. The whole idea of sustainability is you cannot achieve it individually.
Mm-hmm.
We have to work collectively.
Exactly.
Wherever we can draw the resources and the manpower and the mindset and the value system, we definitely mm-hmm. should work in that direction.
No, Thank you so much for coming to our show. This is like an amazing, amazing opportunity for me to understand what sustainability meant for all of us. And I'm sure our viewers would also concur and join Professor Shashi Kant and everyone else in developing the new philosophy of sustainability. Thank you so much, Dr. Shashi Kant.
Thank you, Chankishore. You're most welcome.